Hello all, welcome back to BTU e-Sikshana program. I, Dr. Susmita Mahapatra, is here to take the module 2 of antennas, microwave and antenna, which is a prescribed subject for 6th semester electronics communication and telecommunication students. As you know, in this module, we are going to talk regarding microwave network theory and microwave passive devices. So in the previous classes, we have already finished microwave network theory, and now in the 6th class we are going to do microwave attenuators. So basically we know what is one amplifier and what is one attenuator. When we tell one attenuator, the signal strength, or I can rather tell the amplitude of the signal, is going to be reduced. Okay, so when the amplitude of the signal is going to be reduced, the power carried by the signal is going to be reduced when we are doing attenuation. So what are basically this microwave passive attenuators? So as the name suggests, these are passive devices which are used in the microwave circuitry or in a microwave system to control the power levels which is generated or which is the input in the microwave system. Now how they are going to attenuate this power, whatever it is given at the input side, is basically either they absorb a part of the transmitted signal which is going to pass through the transmission line, or they can also absorb sometimes the complete signal. So it depends on our requirement. So these passive devices are a part of microwave system where either they are going to absorb the power carried in the transmission wave partially or completely. Basically, these attenuators, according to their work nature, they are divided into two categories. One is a fixed attenuator, one is a variable attenuator. Now, when we are talking regarding a fixed attenuator, the amount of attenuation is going to be fixed. We cannot change it. In a variable attenuator, very simple, we can change how much attenuation as per the requirement, as per the application, we can change how much attenuation we want. In both the cases, we are going to use the same thing, that is a dielectric coated with a resistive film. Okay. Now, what happens here? What is the working principle? So let us talk separately fixed attenuator and variable attenuator. Now we know that whenever we have some resistive material, so they oppose. So resistive material, they give opposition or they oppose the flow of the signal. Now what happens? Already we have studied in principle of communication system that in resistance we get certain noise that is called as a thermal noise. Now why it happens? So these resistive materials, usually when they oppose, they will have a tendency to absorb some of the signal. When they are opposing the signal to flow, they are absorbing some of the signal. Now that signal is having a tendency to raise the temperature of the device or the resistive device, whatever you are using, and that is dissipated in terms of heat. So usually wherever we have a resistive material and we have certain signal, so we are going to get some loss, some power loss in terms of dissipation. So we call it as a dissipated power loss. What is the power loss due to dissipation? Now here in this fixed attenuator, so you can see in the picture what we have tried to show is we have just, it is something like we have opened the rectangular waveguide. Okay, so we have opened the rectangular waveguide here and we are showing that in the middle section or in the major part of the rectangular waveguide where the main electric field is going to exist due to the electromagnetic wave, we are going to place a dielectric coated with some resistive material. Now you can see the dielectric is going to be tapered at both the end. So the resistive material is the resistive material here. So it is tapered on both the end. Why we do this? In order to avoid reflection. So only thing is we want to absorb the signal. Depending on how much attenuation we want to do, we don't want to have any loss because of reflection due to this device. So we have tapered both the ends so that there should be an impedance matching and there should not be any reflection. Now what happens? So here, the waves, if you are considering the electromagnetic waves, so electromagnetic waves are associated with electric field and magnetic field. Now the wave which is propagating in Z direction, okay, so if we are taking this as the Z direction, this is my wave propagation direction through the waveguide, then this wave is going to be associated with electric field and magnetic field. Now it will have the electric field which is going to be perpendicular with respect to Z direction. We know that electric and magnetic field should be perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So we will have the electric field which is going to be in this way. But practically what happens, some electric field may be a little bit twisted. We can have some electric field like this. Now these fields, when they come across this resistive material, if they have little twisting, so they generate one angle theta with this parallel line, with this line, or rather I'll tell with the Z axis. Now because of this, they will have certain parallel components or the components of electric field which is going to exist on this Z axis, that is, which are going to be parallel with the dielectric or the resistive material which is present here. Now what happens? This resistive material which is present here is going to absorb these parallel components of the electric field which are aligned parallel with respect to this resistive material. Now because of absorption of that parallel components, the net electric field is going to reduce. So whenever we are absorbing the electric field, so net, the power carried in the wave is going to reduce. So as a result, the output we are going to get, we can tell that it is attenuated. Now in this structure, how much power is going to be absorbed by this resistive material, or how much power is going to be dissipated in this resistive material, that is fixed. Because the alignment of this resistive material is fixed, we are not going to vary its length as well as its position. So how much power is going to be absorbed by this resistive material is also fixed. So that is called a fixed attenuator. So as I told, the dielectric strip is going to reduce some of the electric field which is going to propagate parallel to the resistive material. Now coming for the next type of attenuator. So this is a variable attenuator. Now you can see this picture. It is a variable attenuator. So here also what we are trying to do, here also we have introduced the dielectric with a resistive field. Okay, coated with the resistive field. Now what we want to do, we want the same way this resistive film should absorb some part of the electric field which is parallel to the resistive field. That is what is the concept. The concept is always same. But in this case, you can see the resistive film is movable. This dielectric which is coated with resistive film is movable. How? We have here the resistive film connected by two dielectric rods, okay, and the distance between these two dielectric rods is a odd multiple of quarter wavelength, that is lambda by 4. Why we do this? So that we can have an impedance matching and we should not have any other loss. For that we do this. Now these dielectric rods are connected by a screw gauge kind of system which is nothing but one micrometer. Okay, we are connected by this. Now, if we'll rotate this, if this screw gauge or this micrometer we will rotate, then you can see this dielectric rods, they can be taken off or they can be brought down. Now, when the dielectric rods are taken off or they can be brought down, then the resistive film which is associated with this dielectric rod is also moving inside this cross-sectional area of the rectangular waveguide. Now, when the wave is propagating, as I told you, it is associated with the electric field, and we may have certain parts of electric field which are coming parallel to this section. Now, when these electric fields are coming across this resistive film, so they are going to be again absorbed by the resistive field, and that is going to give us a result in the attenuation of the signal. Some power is absorbed and that is going to result in the reduction of the power, and that is we call the signal is getting attenuated. Now, In this case also, whatever the resistive film coated dielectric we are using, that is tapered at both the ends it is tapered, so that we should not have any reflection. Okay, we don't have any reflection because of this resistive film. Only thing is, it is going to attenuate the signal, it is going to absorb a part of the signal depending on how much part of the electric field is coming across or parallel to this resistive film. Okay. Now here, when we are moving this resistive film, sometimes the cross-sectional area of the resistive film comes completely across this electric field. So at that time, the absorption of the signal is going to be more, and so also the attenuation of the signal is going to be more. If it is lifted down or lifted up, it is not completely at the middle of the rectangular waveguide cross-section, then accordingly, maybe little less electric field is going to be absorbed by this resistive film. So accordingly, the attenuation is going to change. So basically, what we are doing here, we are changing the position of this resistive film through the cross-sectional area of this rectangular waveguide. By changing the position of the resistive film, the absorption of the electric field, which is parallel to the resistive film, the amount of absorption is going to change. Now, when the amount of absorption is going to change, accordingly, the attenuation is going to change. How much attenuation we are going to get at the output, so that is also changing. So this is called as a variable attenuator. The principle is going to be same both in fixed attenuator as well as variable attenuator. But in this, how much attenuation we want, that can be changed. Now for that, I will show you one attenuator that you are going to use in your lab. So you can see here, as I told you, I have got a screw guards type of system, which we call it as a micrometer here. Now inside this, so we have, this is our rectangular waveguide. Now inside this, we have a path where the wave is going to propagate. Now I have taken the resistive material completely off. So the wave is going to propagate through this rectangular waveguide without any disturbance. It is free to move from one side to other side. It is free to move. So there is no disturbance. There is no attenuation of the signal. Now if I'm turning this micrometer and I'm bringing it down. So as you can see, I'm bringing it down. So what you can see in the cross-sectional area of the rectangular waveguide, you can see one small black portion coming down. So that is nothing but my resistive film or dielectric with a resistive film. So when it is coming down, if I'm bringing it completely down, when you can see here, it is coming down. You can see in the cross-sectional area, one rod kind of thing is coming down. Now this is the main resistive film, which is coming as an obstruct between the flow of the electromagnetic field. Now this is going to absorb the electric field, whichever is going to be parallel to this resistive film. And because of that absorption, the final output is also going to reduce, or some power is absorbed, the signal is attenuated, and the final power is going to reduce. Okay, so this is how. So when I take it off, so if I'm taking it off, I don't have any cross-sectional insertion of any resistive film, so the output is going to be maximum. But when I'm bringing, so this moment output is going to be maximum, and when I'm bringing it down, the micrometer position, I'm bringing it down completely. So accordingly, the position of the resistive film is going to change. You can see here, there is one obstacle. You can see a black line coming across the rectangular waveguide cross section. So this is nothing but my resistive film. So this is one example of variable attenuator. So we have a special case in this variable attenuator, which is known as a precision variable attenuator. Okay? This is very important with respect to the exam. So if we see this precision variable attenuator construction first. So what we have here, you can see initially we have a rectangular waveguide section. We have a rectangular waveguide section. Then coming to this portion, you can see we have a rectangular to circular transition. So here, till here, I can tell my waveguide is a rectangular waveguide, but coming to this portion, the waveguide is changing to one circular waveguide. So we have a transition from rectangular to circular waveguide here. Now again, after this, whatever the path we can see here coming from, if we'll see coming from here, the point of R1. So here, so from here to completely, if I'm taking, so this portion is going to be your completely circular waveguide section. Okay, this portion is completely a circular waveguide section. Now, R1, we can tell from R1 to R3, if you are taking from R1 to R3, we can tell that it is our circular waveguide section. Now, after R3, again, when we enter to RC2, it is again one transition section where again it is changing from circular to rectangular. Okay. So basically, at the input side, we have a rectangular to circular transition section. And at the output side, we again have one circular to rectangular transition system. So in this center portion, what we have? So initially, we have a resistive material R1. Okay. Now this R1 is going to be fixed. So it is a tapered resistive rod, very simple. And it is fixed. That is, it is not going to change its position. It is fixed and it is kept like this. Now then, what we have? We have R2. This is one more resistive rod. So tapered resistive rod. When I'm telling tapered means this resistive rods are not going to give any reflection. So they are tapered to have a proper impedance matching. So we don't have any reflection due to this resistive material. Only thing is we are going to have certain absorption and attenuation because of that. So this is my second resistive rod, which is kept at the central part of this circular waveguide, and this is not fixed. It is a rotating resistive rod. So it can rotate for 0 to 360 degree. The middle one can rotate from 0 to 360 degree. Now, coming to the third part, again, what we have? We have one more resistive rod, which is written as R3, and this resistive rod is again going to be fixed. Now, the wave is propagating in Z direction. So this direction, we can take that the wave is propagating. So obviously, we are going to have the electric field either in X direction or Y direction. Let us consider that we have the electric field in the Y direction. So this is the direction shown for the electric field. Now, always, let us assume that the wave is propagating in dominant mode through this waveguide. Okay, let it be rectangular waveguide or let it be circular waveguide. The wave is propagating in dominant mode. Now, question comes, what is one dominant mode? You would have studied it in your model one. Now, basically, a waveguide is considered as a high pass filter. Okay, high pass filter, we know the characteristics of a high pass filter. If we want to do, this is something like this. So this axis gives you a frequency and this axis gives you the gain. Now here, what happens when we are doing one high pass filter, it has a low cutoff frequency. Okay, it is associated with a low cutoff frequency. Now any signal having a frequency more than this low cutoff frequency is allowed to pass through the waveguide. Okay, so waveguide is working as a high pass filter with associated with a low cutoff frequency. Now, what is a dominant mode? So dominant mode is one where the waveguide is associated with lowest cutoff frequency. So beyond this frequency or below this frequency, none of the signal is allowed to pass through the rectangular or circular waveguide for any waveguide. Okay. So dominant mode is one which is associated with lowest cutoff frequency. Okay. It's the lowest cutoff frequency. Now, here in this case, since we have two waveguides. One is a rectangular waveguide, one is a circular waveguide. We should know what is the dominant mode for the rectangular waveguide. For the rectangular mode waveguide, the dominant mode is TE10, okay, for a rectangular waveguide. And when we take a circular waveguide, the dominant mode is TE11. Okay, it is for the circular waveguide. Now, specifically, I'll not go very deep into what is this TE10 and all. So, TE10, TE11, it comes from a standard TEMN. So, this MN keeps on changing according to the number of waves or half waves present in the x-axis and y-axis, or this section, x-axis and y-axis if you are taking. So, how many waves or half waves are present in this x-axis and y-axis, depending on that, this M and N is going to change. Right. So, as we are assuming that here the wave is propagating in a dominant mode, so when it is entering the rectangular waveguide, the wave is propagating with a dominant mode which is TE10. So, at the entry label, the wave is propagating with TE10 mode. Now, coming further, when it is entering to the circular waveguide section, the dominant mode is changing. For a circular waveguide, the mode of propagation is changing to TE11. So, you can see here at the rectangular waveguide section, we have written the mode of propagation is TE10, here also TE10. Coming to the circular section, the mode of propagation is going to be TE11, here also it is TE11. Right. Now, with this, let us see how the wave is going to propagate. So, whatever I told you, everything is related to the construction. Okay. And coming for operation, as I told, so in the incident part, the wave is with TE10 dominant mode. And as it comes to the rectangular to circular waveguide, it changes to TE11. Okay. Now, let us see how this wave is going to propagate or how it is going to be attenuated. Now, let us consider the first resistive film. As I told you, it is going to be fixed, and this is also going to be fixed. So, they are aligned fixed. Okay, these two resistive films. So, the first one and the third one, the last one, they are going to be fixed and they are aligned just on the cross section of the rectangular of the waveguide, rather let us tell over the waveguide. In the center one, the resistive material R2, as I told, it can be changed from 0 to 360 degree. It is a movable resistive film which can move from 0 to 360 degree. So let us fix it with one angle of theta. Suppose it is kept with respect to x-axis or with respect to y-axis. Rather, let us take y-axis because we are considering the electric field in y-axis here. So the angle of the presence of the middle resistive let us take it as with an angle of theta. Now what happens? Ideally, we have considered that the electric fields are happening like this. That is, they are existing in the y direction. The wave is propagating in z direction. So this electric field, as I told you now, always they may not be perpendicular. They may have a part of the electric fields which are not completely perpendicular. They are bending somehow. Okay. Now, anyway, if they are perfectly perpendicular, they are not going to be getting attenuated by the first resistive field R1. If they are little bit not completely perpendicular, little bit twisted, then in that case, if we have any parallel component which is coming across R1, they are going to be attenuated. Fine. Now, what we have here the incident field. I can write it is EI coming in the y direction. And that field or those electric fields passing from the resistive material R1, they are entering to the section where we have the resistive material R2. Now, as we told, we have R2 kept with respect to the y-axis at one angle of theta. So this is a movable resistive material which is kept at an angle of theta. Now, if this is our incident electric field E, then when it comes across this resistive material, we are going to get two components. One parallel component taking this angle theta when this is E. So this component is E cos theta, and one perpendicular component which is coming here is E sin theta. Okay. So basically, this resistive material is going to give us two components. One is E cos theta, E sin theta, where E cos theta is parallel to the resistive material and E sin theta is perpendicular to the resistive material. Now, repeatedly, I have told you, if we have any electric field which is parallel to the resistive material, then that is going to be absorbed by this resistive material. So here, since E cos theta is parallel to this resistive material, so it is going to be absorbed by this resistive material. Okay. Now, going beyond R2, when we are going further in the waveguide section and we are reaching to R3, so what we have, since E cos theta is completely absorbed by R2, so we are left only with E sin theta. Okay. Now, this E sin theta, if you are taking it with x-axis or the direction how the resistive material is kept, because this is my third resistive material, which is again fixed along the cross section of the waveguide, if we'll check. So this is making one angle theta. Now here I have the electric field falling on this resistive material or coming across this resistive material is E sin theta, which is again coming with one angle theta with respect to the third resistive material R3. Now, because of this alignment, again, we are going to get two resultant electric fields. One is perpendicular, that is E sin square theta, and one is parallel to the resistive material, that is E sin theta cos theta. Now, as we have discussed, this E sin theta cos theta part of the electric field is going to be absorbed by this resistive material. Now, when it is going to be absorbed by this resistive material, then as an output coming out from the waveguide, the final output that we are going to get is E sin square theta. So the input we have given here is E. And finally, after all the three resistive material, the final output that we are going to get is E sin square theta. Okay. Now let us see what is the attenuation. So attenuation, if we'll calculate alpha, the attenuation is given as alpha. So that is equal to how much electric field is incident, that is E, and divided by how much is your final output, that is E sin square theta. So this gives me 1 by sin square theta. So the attenuation factor that we are going to get in this rectangular or in this waveguide because of this resistive material is sin square theta. And since if we are trying to write it in terms of S parameter, since we are giving the input at 1, taking it out at port 2, we can tell. So in that case, this is written as S21. Okay. Now, presenting the attenuation in terms of decibels, so because it is in the denominator, we have got minus. And since it is square term is there, so 2 into 20, it gives us 40 log sine theta. Okay. Similarly, for H21, if we are putting, it is in the denominator. So we are getting minus and 20 log H21. Okay. So in that case, how we can write the final S matrix for this precision attenuator. So one more thing we have to take, we can consider the attenuators as reciprocal device, matched reciprocal device. Why matched? Because repeatedly I was telling all the resistive materials were tapered at the end so that we should not have any reflection due to impedance mismatch. Rather, we have properly matching impedance here. So we can tell that the attenuator are properly reciprocal devices. So reciprocal devices, so S12 can be taken as S21 when they are properly matched. Okay. Now in that case, how to write the S matrix if you are taking? So S11, since they are properly matched, so we can take S11 is equal to S22 is equal to 0. The first thing we can assume is S11 equal to S22 equal to 0. And thing, since S12 is equal to S21, that is my reciprocal property of the attenuator we are considering. So how much we got? S21, S12, it is equal to sine square theta. So in this way, the S matrix can be written as, since it is two ports, it is two class two matrix where the diagonal elements are going to be zero, and we have here sine square theta, sine square theta. And yes, the S11, S22, we have taken it as zero, which is equal to VSWR minus one. I hope you know what is VSWR. So when we have reflection in the waveguide, and due to mismatch of the impedance, so when the reflected wave gets superimposed on the incident wave, it results in the standing wave. Now, standing wave, somewhere it has maximum voltage, somewhere it has minimum voltage. If they don't have any difference, then the VSWR is going to be almost one. So here we expect that there is no reflection. So in that case, we are taking that, or maybe very little reflection. So in that case, we are writing that our value of VSWR minus one by VSWR plus one is very, very less than 0.01. So considering this, we have made the diagonal elements zero, and the final output is sine square theta and sine square theta. Okay. So this is the S matrix representation for one precision attenuator. I hope it is clear to all. So thank you all. And we will meet in the next class where we will be discussing regarding some other microwave passive devices. Till then, we will, so bye till then. So we will meet in our next class. Thank you.